Hi, I'm Jeff, and I'm a senior analytic training consultant in SaaS education. In this video, I'm going to continue to introduce Model Studio for the Enterprise Miner user. But remember, even if you don't use Enterprise Miner, you're going to learn some things about Model Studio. In this video, I'm going to talk about all things related to data. I'll show you how to create a data source in Enterprise Miner, and in Model Studio, I'm going to actually load data into memory when I create a project and show you some things in the data tab. Let's go ahead and jump into the video. So I'm going to pick up where I left off in that last video. I have created a project called YouTube, and I've created a diagram called My Diagram. The My Diagram diagram is open. Before I create a data source, I first need to create a library. Sometimes libraries can be pre-configured, but Enterprise Miner gives the user an ability to create a library also. A library is just a connection between a SaaS tool and where the data lives. I'll use the File pull-down menu and go to File, New, Library. At the Library Wizard, step one, I'll create a new library. Click Next. For the name, I'll call it YouTube. That's the same name as the project, but that's okay. For the path, I'm going to point to the location where the data is stored. I'll click Browse. And the data is located at D, Workshop, WinSAS, in a folder called AAEM. I'll highlight that folder and click OK. I could provide an option or summary if I wanted to. No need to do so. I'll click Next. A summary of the actions. The library's been created. I'll click Finish. So in Enterprise Miner, the data source is the raw data, but it also has additional metadata. Metadata is information about the variables and information about the table itself. We'll define the metadata during the process of creating the data source. I could use the File pull-down menu and go to File, New Data. I could use the shortcut button or the starburst to go to New Data, or I can right-click on the Data Sources folder within the project panel. Right-click and create data source. Step one says we're going to bring in a SAS table. That's the format of the underlying data, so I'll click Next. Step two says, what's the table? We'll browse to it. I'll click Browse. Here's the libraries. Many of them have been pre-configured. I'll scroll to the bottom, and I see the YouTube library that I created a moment ago. I'll open that location. And the data set that I'm going to bring in is called PVA97NK. This is data from a national veterans organization that's trying to predict whether or not individuals might donate to their organization. I'll highlight the name of the table and click OK. That brings us back to step two of the Data Wizard, where I'll click Next. Step three is some summary information about the data table itself. I'll click Next to go to step four. Step four is where Enterprise Miner is offering me help in establishing the metadata about the data table. First, let's see what we get with the basic advisor. I'll keep basic selected and click Next. For the role under the basic advisor, all variables are input unless Enterprise Miner recognizes a variable name containing ID, where it assigns the role of ID automatically, and also if Enterprise Miner recognizes the name target in a variable name, the role of target is assigned. Notice also that for measurement level, the only thing we're seeing is interval or nominal. If the underlying variable is numeric, a measurement level of interval is assigned. If the underlying variable is class or categorical, a measurement level of nominal is assigned. Those are the only things you'll get under the basic advisor. So it looks like we've got two targets, target underscore B, target underscore D. They both have a role of target and they both have a measurement level of interval. Let's see how they're different. In Enterprise Miner, I can actually explore the variables from this current window. I'll select both target B and target D, and then I'll click the Explore button. This is historic or prior data for the veterans organization. It turns out that the variable target D is the numeric amount of money that they've donated in the past, and target B, you can see by looking at the histogram and also the raw data itself in the window on the left, that that's a binary variable of whether or not an individual donated. So for the metadata, it would actually be more appropriate to have a measurement level of binary for target B. Let's do a couple of steps and have Enterprise Miner do that for us automatically. I'll close the Explore window. That brings us back to step 5. And remember, the basic metadata options got us to this point. Let me back up to go back to step 4 again. Notice there's a radio button for advanced. I want to use those advanced metadata options. I'll click advanced, and to see what they are, I'll click customize. The advanced options do things such as reject variables if it has too much missing information. It can take numeric variables with a small number of numeric values and convert them to categorical. It can also reject categorical variables that have too many levels. I'll click OK. That brings us back to step 4, where again, we'll keep the advanced metadata options selected. Click Next. First, let's take a look at our target variables. Scrolling down, we now see that target B has a measurement level of binary. That's what we'd expect. Target D still has the measurement level of interval. Notice that a couple of the other variables also now have measurement levels of binary. And we also see that Enterprise Miner has rejected a variable called DemCluster. Let's explore it and see if we can determine why Enterprise Miner rejected that variable. I'll highlight it and click Explore. We see a bar chart of that variable in the lower right-hand corner. And if I click that yellow triangle, we'll see the horizontal axis with all values shown. And we see that there's actually 54 values for that variable. Remember, under the Advanced Advisor, Enterprise Miner will reject a categorical variable that has too many levels, and that's exactly what we're seeing here. Let's go back to the prior step. I'll close the Explore window. And even though Enterprise Miner can deal with two target variables, for example, if it's doing two-stage modeling, for this application, I'll reject one of the variables and only keep the binary variable as the target. So let me show you how to manually change metadata. I'll select target D. I want to change the role, so I'll click on target under the role column and manually change the role to rejected. Click Next. We go to step 6. Notice that the number of steps in the wizard has updated. Enterprise Miner automatically changes the number of steps in the wizard based on what the metadata it sees. Step 6 is for decision processing. We're not going to do any at this point, so we'll keep that as no. Step 7 allows for a subsample of the data set to be taken. We don't need one, so we'll keep that as no. Step 8 of 9 is the role of the table. How do we intend to use the table? We can see what some of the options are there. I can assign a role of scoring, training, validation, transaction. For our data, we'll keep the role as raw. Click Next to go to the final step. It provides a summary of all of the column metadata. We can click Finish. And now in the upper left-hand corner, we see that the PVA data is available in the project panel. Again, if I want to see or change any of the variable metadata, I can right-click on the name of the data source, go to Edit Variables. This window should look familiar. It's very similar to what we saw under the data source wizard. I could make changes if I wanted to. No need to do so. And if I wanted to explore the data, I could do that further as well. Right-click on the data source name, go to Explore. The Explore window is going to show me the raw data itself. There it is in the bottom window. We see some summary statistics of the data in the upper right-hand window. And I could also go to the plot wizard if I wanted to do any advanced plots to explore that data. I'll close that window. That takes us back to the diagram where we left off. Now let's go ahead and compare and contrast some of those things in Model Studio. All right, now I'm in Model Studio and I can't pick up with the same project I created in the earlier video because remember in Model Studio, different than Enterprise Miner, I have to deal with the data during the creation of that project. So I'm going to create a new project and I'll call this one YouTube 2. For the type, data mining machine learning will be fine. For the template, we'll keep that template as blank. That's something I'll be addressing in a future video. In my last video, I imported data that was already in memory. This time I want to do something different. Next to the data property, I'll click Browse. For the Choose Data window, notice there's three tabs in the upper left-hand corner. The Available tab shows data already in memory. The Import tab allows me to import data from a local location into the CAS server. The data source can point to data that's already in CAS, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's already loaded in memory. The data that I want is in that scenario. I'll click Data Sources, and I'll browse to the location. CAS Shared Default, Public, and this is a very similar copy of the data we looked at in Enterprise Miner, PVA. Now again, in this case, the data is on the CAS server, but it's not loaded into memory. You'll see that it's going to create a copy of the file and there's going to be a special symbol once that data is loaded into memory that I'll show you. I can right click on the PVA data and click Load, or I can select the file. And in the upper right-hand corner, there's a shortcut button that looks like a lightning bolt that will also load the data into memory. Let me click that shortcut button. Notice now on the panel on the left, we see two versions of the PVA data, the original SAS HDAT file and the new version with no extension. Notice the symbol next to the new copy of the PVA data. It has a little lightning bolt on it. That's what indicates that's the in-memory copy of the table. That's what I need to create my project. With that new version of PVA selected, I'll click OK. And that brings us back to the new project window. Now, remember in Enterprise Miner, we saw and talked about those advanced metadata options. Well, Model Studio has something very similar, and it's available through the new project window. I'll click Advanced. And notice the first option that appears is Advisor Options. And these are essentially the same options we saw in Enterprise Miner. For example, it will reject a class variable that has too many levels. It will also reject a variable that has too much missing information. We're not going to make any changes to the Advanced Advisor Options, so I'll click Save. That brings us back to the new project window. I'll click Save again. We're automatically at the data tab and we see a warning at the top. Only one variable can have a role of target. Remember in Enterprise Miner, we saw that there were two targets in this data set. Let's go ahead and scroll down and see what we have here. Scrolling down in the data tab, I see that for this slightly different version of the PVA data, there's actually three targets: target underscore B, target underscore D, and target underscore D with zero. Notice that target underscore B has a measurement level of binary. The advanced options were kicked in automatically. To address the warning at the top of the data tab, I need only one target variable. So let me reject target D and target D with zero. I'll select the checkbox next to both of those variable names to highlight them simultaneously. And in the right-hand panel, I'll go ahead and change the role to rejected. That will update the metadata for both of those target variables. They're now rejected, and we see the warning across the top go away. Now, what if I want to explore the variables in any way? There'd be a couple of things I could do. There's a shortcut button at the top if I want to view the raw data itself. I'll click the button for View Table. We're still on the data tab, but the view gets updated. I see the columns now with their actual raw values. That allows me to see the actual data in its original format. Let me go back to the column view. If I wanted to graphically explore the data, there'd be another option I could do. On the left-hand column, I'll click the shortcut button for data sources. And notice that when I expand data sources, there's another shortcut button for explore and visualize. I'm not going to do that now, but by clicking that button, it actually takes the data set into another VIA tool called Visual Analytics, where I could do further exploration or visualization of the data. Again, there's no need to do that at this time. Before I wrap up this video, I'm going to show you some additional features that Model Studio has that Enterprise Miner does not have. Let me click on one of the interval measurement level variables, DemAge. In Model Studio, the metadata is more than just the role and measurement level of the variables. Notice in the property pane on the right, DemAge is selected, but I can also assign different types of transformations to the variable, different types of imputation, and other data pre-processing. So on the data tab, I can assign rules to the variables that are data pre-processing rules. I would need to invoke those rules in a pipeline with the necessary node. I'm not going to do that now. We'll be seeing that in another video. Well, I hope you enjoyed that video on all things data related to Enterprise Miner and Model Studio. Definitely check out Model Studio soon if you can. Please feel free to leave me a question down below if you've got one. Check out the additional resources there as well. Give me a thumbs up on the video, and don't forget to subscribe to the SaaS Users channel. Until next time, this is Jeff. I'll see you later.